Now, up until this point, I've been talking about matter and energy in fairly generic terms, the rules of how they operate, but still keeping things fairly generic. And at this point, I'd like to get a bit more specific with matter. Now, as you should recall, energy is the capacity to move matter, but what is matter? Well, certainly it's anything that has mass and takes up space. The most fundamental unit of matter we typically encounter in biology in general, and certainly in human physiology, would be the chemical element. So let's take a look here at least part of the periodic table of the elements. Now, this is only the first 54 elements. And I'll level with you. I'd taken that chemistry course where the professor comes in the first day and informs us, by the end of this course, you will have memorized the entire periodic table. And I've never seen the point to that philosophically, because that basically just encourages you as a student to engage in a huge and unproductive game of memorize and forget. What I'd rather do is focus on those elements that you're going to encounter so often that you really do need to memorize them. So starting here with the first 54 elements, let's isolate 19 nutritionally important elements. Now, these 19 elements are substances where we know they serve a physiological function within the human body. There are other elements that are taken in the diet. Some nutritional supplement companies sell them as supplements, but these are 19 where we know what they do. We're not simply taking them in because they're on planet Earth. We're taking them in because we're actually going to use them in a particular way. Now, of these 19, some of them, as important as they are, you're not going to actually encounter them that often. So, for example, boron is important as an enzyme cofactor for utilizing vitamin D. Manganese, copper, and molybdenum are important as enzyme cofactors in cellular metabolism. Now, those are all important processes, but you're not going to dig into the roles of these elements terribly often. Zinc is another enzyme that's enzyme cofactor of importance, and it's also important both in metabolic enzymes, but also enzymes like carbonic anhydrase. And then selenium is an important cofactor for antioxidant enzymes. Now, all of those elements are important, but you're really not going to encounter them very often. What you have left on the screen here are the 13 most commonly encountered elements in the human body. You need to know these 13, and I want to give you a brief tour of how these 13 are used where you're going to encounter them. So let's start with two of the trace elements, elements that aren't used in large quantities but have a very important and frequently encountered role. Iron is used in forming the proteins hemoglobin and myoglobin, which are used for the transport and storage of oxygen, and it's also a very important enzymatic cofactor. Another important trace element is iodine. This is used in forming the thyroid hormones triiodothyronine and tetraiodothyronine, which you'll encounter when you get to anatomy and physiology too. Seven of the remaining 11 elements are consumed in smaller quantities than the other four because of how often, or rather what they're used for, but they're all used for very important functions. So to walk through them, we have magnesium, which is a major metabolic cofactor and also plays a role in maintaining bone structure. We have sodium, which is important in neuromuscular function and water balance. Phosphorus, which is important in both bone structure and cellular energy transfers. Sulfur, which is very important in generalized protein structure. Chlorine, which is important in neuromuscular function and in acid-base or pH balance. Potassium, which is important for neuromuscular function. And calcium, which is a very critical intra or within cellular messenger that also plays a role in bone structure, blood clotting, and neuromuscular function. Now, let me be clear, with those 11 elements I just rattled through, they have other functions than what I just named. I'm just hitting the high points. That leaves us with the big four, the four most abundant elements in the human body, and they're the most abundant because they form the organic molecules that we're really built from more than any others, the lipids, the carbohydrates, the proteins, and the nucleic acids within our cells. From most to least abundant, they are oxygen, which accounts for about 65% of body mass, carbon, which accounts for about 18.5%, hydrogen, which accounts for about 9.5%, and nitrogen, which accounts for about 3.2%. And the thing to realize with all 13 of these elements is you're going to encounter them frequently enough that you have to recognize their atomic symbols and you have to know how to correctly write their atomic symbols. So let's take a look at this briefly. There are several easy ones, seven in fact. Carbon, hydrogen, iodine, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur. All seven of these elements have as their atomic symbol their first letter, so that's nice and easy. Three others are fairly easy. Calcium has as its atomic symbol Ca, chlorine is Cl, and magnesium is Mg. The three most challenging are the three elements whose atomic symbol is derived not from their English name at all, or even related to their English name, but derived from either their Latin or their Greek name. So iron is Fe, potassium is K, and sodium is Na. Now, if you put in the time, you should fairly easily be able to memorize these atomic symbols. Now, in my course, it's really critical to me that you also know how to correctly write them, not just read them, but write them. And I lower my exam scores for students who cannot write these correctly. So let's do a quick lesson in how not to write them, because you have to get used to, if you're going to work in the health sciences, people telling you what the conventions are for doing abbreviation. It's just part of life. So here are four different ways in which the atomic symbol for sodium has been written. The bottom left is not acceptable. It's not capital N, capital A. That isn't correct. It's never correct. Nor is it lowercase n, lowercase a. The middle looks good to people, but I find that every bit as unacceptable as what's on the left. Just because you write the second letter smaller than the first doesn't make it lowercase. The only correct way, as far as I'm concerned, to write the atomic symbol for sodium is as seen in the top center, capital N, lowercase a. You need to know this. So, with that said, you have 13 commonly encountered elements that you need to know atomic symbols for. Hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen are the most foremost abundant. And then sodium, magnesium, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, potassium, calcium, iron, and iodine will also be frequently encountered. And the most fundamental unit of any of these elements is the atom. Guess what we're going to look at next?